everybody. Welcome. Welcome to the last day of RSA Conference. I can't believe it's the last day. Thanks so much for being here. Thanks so much for staying through, persevering. I hope you've had a good time this week. In just a little while, Stephen Colbert will be on this stage. I know. But before that, I'd like to spend a little while talking about the intersection of privacy and analytics. So you've talked a lot this week about analytics. You've seen a lot of analytics buzzwords show up in sessions and presentations. But it's interesting to think, as people share more about themselves online and have a longer tail of history, what are the implications as we get better at analytics? Like, can you determine who will be the ideal employee, who will be the best mate, who's the person that you want to pick to team up with in a science lab? So there's a lot of open questions about analytics, and it closely ties into privacy. I've got two amazing guests that will be out here in just a little bit to talk about this. But before they come out, just to set the stage, I want to share a personal security story with you. So I lived in Asia for about 5 months last year, and my whole family was there. And one of the last things we did was go to vacation in Bali. So I don't know, how many people here have ever been to Bali, just out of curiosity? Okay, some people, some hands. Well, those of you that have been there and those of you who are looking to go there, the main attraction is this place called the Monkey Forest. And it's like, it's literally like thousands of wild monkeys. Right? And I was so excited to see this place. You know, I had this vision of what it'd be like. I have two very young kids, so we watched Curious George. I don't know if you've ever seen that. That's my model of what a monkey is, kind of friendly, a little mischievous. You know, I had these thoughts about maybe hugging a monkey, getting a photo with it, that type of thing. So we get to this monkey forest, and there's somebody selling bananas right at the entrance, right? So I buy a bushel of bananas, you know, get one for my wife. My brother-in-law is with us, and we kind of walk into the first area of this thing, and immediately greeted by 10 pretty large monkeys. And I'm like, oh, this is going to be fantastic. So, you know, I break the ice, pull out a banana, break it off, throw it to one of them, peels it, eats it. I'm like, this is amazing. My brother-in-law, same thing, throws one out. But my wife is like incredibly stingy with her banana stash. And she doesn't throw any out, like no token banana. And suddenly I see these monkeys like looking at each other, looking at her, and then they just attack. Like I've never, it's like a monkey swarm, right? And so I see my wife screaming and weaponizing the bananas, right? So she's pulling them off, pelting them off, and then finally she just throws the entire bushel at them, and we run off kind of deeper into this this monkey forest. So we're pretty disheveled, you know, don't quite know what to do. My whole image about the monkey and the hug and all that stuff gets shattered. And so then we're just kind of trying to regroup, and I have a photo that I'll share with you. I think we have here. So this is me on the left. This is my brother-in-law Jonathan, and you'll notice if you look kind of at the waist area, we've got our remaining bananas kind of stashed in the shirt, right? And kind of held up. And we thought this was brilliant, right? You know, this is amazing. The monkey won't see it. Everything will be fine. I would also like to draw your attention to the mid-sized monkey on the right-hand side of the screen. So this monkey is assessing people as they go by, which we didn't know. So 30 seconds after the shot was taken by my wife, this monkey summons across like maybe 5 or 6 other monkeys. And before I know it, there's a monkey on my back. There's one ripping my shirt apart. My brother-in-law is like battling one on the side. You know, really kind of scary. So finally, you know, those bananas are gone. There's another guy that we see kind of to the left of us. And the monkey apparently noticed a bulge in his left pocket. I saw him go over there, pick the guy's pocket. It had a bag of crackers, took it open, started eating the crackers. So this second wave of monkeys was not as big as the first set, But these are the ones that have had to be more innovative over time. Right? These are the ones that strip you of the stuff. And so finally, okay, we have no food left. You know, we survived the monkey. I want to get a shirt that says it. And we come up to the inner sanctum of this monkey forest, which is near a very large temple. And so we're back there, and there's these much smaller monkeys. And so my wife, you know, a little more open now to the monkey experience. These ones don't look too dangerous. She goes up to one. It immediately is then on her head, takes off this thing. I think it's called a scrunchie that's holding her hair together, right? This hair clip. And then he starts taunting her with it and dancing. I'm like, man, what is going on here? And then I look to the left, and there's another monkey that has a guy's glasses, and he's doing the same thing, right? He starts to say, and then conveniently, a banana seller approaches us from behind. He explains that this is the extortionist group of monkeys. Not quite big enough to pull off the moves of the other monkeys, but they'll actually negotiate. So you buy bananas, you try and offer them one. Monkey says no, give them two, you know, it seems to be open. But they'll actually give you your stuff back if you appropriately give them the right amount of bananas. Now, the thing that was really interesting to me about this is that I watched them for maybe about half an hour after we've been completely, you know, locked down the glasses and everything else, and they seemed to know who would cave and who wouldn't. They had this amazing sense that they built up, almost like a survival sense, that I know if I take this guy's glasses, I'm gonna get a bushel of bananas. And it's a very complex set of behaviors that got down to a very almost instinctual knowledge of these creatures. The thing that I found most fascinating about it is we're moving into this era of analytics. It's not just us in the security space. I think many other areas of technology are moving into the same thing. And the question then becomes, as we get better at analytics, are we able to distill out types of behaviors, types of insights that we've never thought of before, and what are the social implications of that? My first guest is a world-renowned psychologist. And she's developed a test that has just 12 questions. And it turns out that the answers to those 12 questions, the sum of that test, is more predictive about future success than even IQ is. And it's interesting when you see what those questions look like. I think they offer a peek into the future of the types of data we need to be concerned about. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Angela Duckworth from the University of Pennsylvania. Angela, welcome. How are you? Wow. Do you care for a banana?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I don't know. I don't know how
asking.
These things get here.
Yeah,
right?
Oh,
thanks
I'll
so
sell
much.
You one.
Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. This is great.
Now, I first became familiar with your research. I was working on my Plateau Effect book, and I saw some of the papers that you'd written. And we talked maybe about 2.5 years ago. And the thing that was incredible to me is you've got this very simple test, and you've been using it in places like West Point Military Academy to figure out who's going to make it and who isn't going to make it. And it measures something you call grit. What is grit?
Grit is passion and perseverance for extremely long-term goals. So gritty people organize much of their waking life around one superordinate lifelong challenge. And everything that they do, or a lot of what they do, is sort of, you know, furthering that one far-off goal. And it's got two pieces of it, right? One of it is, you know, passion for the long term, not only being interested in something really intensely, but sustaining those interests over years and decades. And then the second part is good old-fashioned perseverance, you know, having defined a passion, you know, working incredibly hard despite, you know, despite everything, failure, setbacks, et cetera.
Tell me about the work that you've been doing at West Point, because your test turned out to be more predictive of who was going to make it than this intense 2-day battery of ninja tests that these guys get put through.
Right. I don't know if they call them ninja tests,
okay, well,
but they're
colloquially,
you know,
colloquially
lots of taxpayer money has gone into them. So West Point, for really decades has been trying to figure out who's going to stay at West Point and who's not going to stay at West Point. Over the course of 4 years, about 25% of an incoming class attrits, drops out. And it's pretty remarkable that they have such a high dropout rate because, you know, getting into West Point's incredibly hard, right? And over the decades, West Point has created what they call the whole candidate score. And it's their best guess of how you're going to do at West Point. It's got SATs, it's got high school rank, it's got expert ratings of your leadership potential, and then it has, you know, it's West Point, so it's got measures of physical talent as well. You know, how fast you can run, how many sit-ups you can do in 60 seconds. And the whole candidate score does predict how well you do at West Point if you stay. Okay. But of course, one out of four West Point cadets won't stay. It has zero predictive power for who is going to stay versus who doesn't. And what does predict, possibly among other things, but the predictor that seems to be the strongest at this point is grit.
That's amazing. And I wanted to go out and take this test myself. I got to admit, I was slightly concerned because it sounds like people who don't do well are pretty much doomed. But
well, you said that, not me.
What was interesting about it is I've taken some of these psychology tests before, and it's weird questions, right? It's like, if you're walking down a sidewalk, are you very careful not to step on the cracks? Like crazy. And you don't know how to answer and which one will make you look crazy or not. You know, right. Like maybe I should be careful about this stuff, and I'm not. But your questions are actually incredibly straightforward.
And that's right, yeah. I mean, they are completely straightforward. It also makes these questions totally fakeable, which is why I don't recommend to companies or the government that they should screen and select applicants for anything based on this test, because it really only works well if the people who are responding to the questions have an incentive to be honest as opposed to dishonest.
Well, let's take a look. I think you brought a couple of those questions so the audience can do a self-assessment.
Yeah. Short grit test.
Maybe so, be slightly depressing.
I'll walk you guys through it, right?
Okay,
so there's one question. The first question is really about your interests, and I'll read it. I've been obsessed with a certain idea or project for a short time, but later lost interest, right? And then you can just, you know, keep it to yourself, but, you know, how much is that statement like you? And then you can see how many points you would get on my scale. And the second question is about perseverance. I am diligent and finish whatever I begin. And again, you can pick the rating and look at the points, and you just add up, right? The first question, the second question, you can get a low score of 2 all the way up to a high score of 10. And the higher the score, the grittier you would be on this extremely crude and brief measure.
Okay, compute your values now. Take your time.
This group should be pretty fast.
Well, yeah, I'd hope. I told him no multiplication on Friday.
Yeah, no decimals.
But the addition is good.
Right.
I've looked at these questions. Yeah. I've made my own assessment, which I will not share among a close group of friends and being recorded. But let me just ask you, hypothetically, if a friend I had scored like a 3 or something,
right?
Like, would that? And just, I mean, just out of curiosity, you know, because I've got
if
a diverse.
Knew someone,
if I
knew someone,
yeah,
had
yeah.
A 3,
so
I wouldn't hire them. I mean, I'll tell you, you know, I. but I
okay,
might.
Okay, that's our time. Thank you for. No, okay.
But I might invite them to a dinner party because they might be really interesting.
Well, okay, but, I guess that's a good.
I mean, every year I select graduate students, right? And
yeah.
And you know, only one maybe a year or even few. And I just don't have time for somebody who is going to be, you know, whatever else they are, but not have these two qualities. So yeah.
Okay. Well, moving on from that a little bit, you know, the thing that I then found very interesting is you've started to do this work. So these obviously you have to be honest for it to be fair. And to your point that, you know, you can't really go out and ask somebody to be honest on these in a job interview. Yes, I always am determined.
Right.
But you've started to do an investigation on computing grit based on the shadow that people cast, the things that they've actually done, like how many years they've been on the soccer team, for example. Tell me about that.
So, to your point about analytics, right, it's kind of applying that approach to personality assessment. And the idea for trying to figure out how gritty somebody is, not by asking them, but looking at what they've done in their life, you know, how they spent their time, actually was not our idea originally. In the 1980s, Educational Testing Service, you know, the nonprofit that makes the SAT and the GRE, they, they developed what they called the follow-through score, which was a way of looking at high school seniors and coding their extracurricular involvements, you know, sports, student government, paid jobs, et cetera, and coding for what they called follow-through and what I would call grit, right? So the way they scored high school seniors' resumes was to give more points for multi-year commitments, right? If you actually did something for 1 year, like I was in French club for 1 year, you would get 0 points, you know, added to your score. And then in addition to multi-year involvements, they were looking for objective evidence of advancement, you know, progression of some kind. MVP, going from JV to varsity, you know, becoming a captain, getting promoted at Domino's, you know, all this would actually accumulate points. And it turns out that in their research in the 1980s, and it's surprising to me that people don't know about this, they actually looked at 100 different personal qualities that might predict how successful people became in college. And not just what their GPA would be in college, but, you know, outstanding achievements in college of any kind, entrepreneurial, for example. And follow-through was the single best predictor of this 100, you know, variable set. And it, you know, out-predicted a lot of things that, you know, people thought should predict, right? You know, like their essay or their interview. So we just adapted that, and we looked at resumes. And I'll just tell you about one study. So we looked at a large group of novice teachers. And novice teachers actually have a high dropout rate, so we're interested in that. And then we also knew that we could measure how successful those teachers were in getting their kids to improve in their standardized test scores. So we had two success outcomes that we were looking at. Without asking a single question about interest and effort over time, but simply coding their resumes for a consistency of interest over time and then demonstrated progression, just the way they had done, you know, back in the 80s, we were able to predict both whether the teachers were going to drop out or not, and also if they didn't drop out, how much they would have taught their kids based on the increases in the kids' standardized test scores. So, you know, so I think what's remarkable about that is, you know, people do leave a residue in their life, you know, that your personality is something which, if you know what you're looking for, you know, other people can see it. There's potential possibly to do this from Facebook feeds or from, you know, for Twitter posts. I know a lot of employers sort of look to see in social media how people are representing themselves or what they're doing. And I guess the second thing I wanted to mention about that study is, it didn't matter what you showed grit in, right? Huh. So it didn't matter whether you were grittily, you know, working your way up the soccer team or, you know, some paid job or, you know, working in a lab. The thing was is that you showed grit in something. And that to us suggests that, you know, it's something about the individual. You know, people who have this tendency to pursue things over the long run with sustained passion and perseverance, you know, it kind of comes out in one domain maybe when they're in high school and college, but then it carries through when you hire them later.
I have to ask you, you know, you're talking to a room of probably the most paranoid people in the world, right? Where I would definitely count
right?
myself in that group. So if you are able to make these kinds of measures, and it sounds like grit is very predictive in nature, right? To your point, you wouldn't hire a graduate student that scored a 3, for example, but you know, somebody that scored an 8 or 9, maybe they would kind of get prioritized on the list. But the question then becomes, as people get better at doing these types of analytics on a Twitter feed, you mentioned,
yeah.
right? What do you think the implications of this are? Right. Wouldn't it be insane to make a hiring decision 2 years from now if that tooling was readily available and there weren't laws to protect?
So you're much better at kind of forecasting into the future about what might be possible. At the present state, the signal-to-noise ratio is so poor that I can publish research studies showing that, you know, my resume codings correlate with later outcomes. But the signal-to-noise ratio is such that I need a few hundred teachers in my sample in order to show that relationship. And just knowing, you know, one thing about one teacher, I wouldn't actually, you know, be comfortable. I was being a little bit glib when I said, well, if you have a 3 out of 10, I'm definitely not hiring you. I would say that collectively, if I look at your application and you seem to me to be a 3 out of 10 based on your recommendations and your resume and whatnot, then I wouldn't. So at present, you know, we don't know how to code Twitter feed or Facebook for personality. if we, you know, make some success, the first thing that we'll probably do is be able to figure out among a lot of people, because then, you know, the signal is a little stronger relative to the noise, we can start to say things. So if we get really good at it, and we can say a lot about one person, knowing, you know, one thing about them, then I think you're raising, you know, great ethical and security questions, which at least for now, we don't have to deal with.
Well, let me ask you this. The, you know, if you look at some of the classic studies in psychology, the marshmallow test, for example, and those folks have been followed for a very long time. And I know that that's slightly different from grit, but it's interesting to see.
It's related, to me,
fascinating to see how correlated it was. Like a four-year-old that could resist the temptation of a marshmallow today, 40 years ago is more. 40 years from now is more likely to be a doctor than somebody who, you know, that type of thing. Is this truly an invariant quality? Like, can you improve grit? Like, if someone did get a 3, for example, on
right.
this test.
Are they doomed?
I wasn't going to say doomed, but yes, are they in serious trouble, and can they improve that? Is there a thing that they can, is there like a personal meditation exercise?
So there's not a personal meditation exercise,
right.
But
our future research topic.
Future research topic. I do think you can develop grit. I think individuals can look at themselves and, you know, see how they score on this thing and do a little introspection and ask whether they do or don't want to be a little grittier. And I do think that there are things that you can do. You know, for one, you can kind of see and model what gritty people tend to do with their lives, right? So I'll just give you one example. We're partnering with a guy who studies experts. So folks in the audience have heard about the 10,000 hour rule, or sometimes it's called the 10-year rule, or maybe you read Outliers, or maybe you were going to read Outliers, and you know, whatever, Wikipedia,
Outliers.
Is that
Outliers. A sign of low grit, if you were going to read it, but you didn't?
Only if it's sort of like part of your superordinate life goal, so if otherwise it's okay. But anyway, so we partner with the scientist who's really behind a lot of that research, not Malcolm Gladwell, but the researcher who studies experts. And you know, if you really want to be gritty, you can look and see, what do Olympic athletes do with their time? How do they organize their lives and their days? And world-class experts tend to, by the way, be gritty and talented, right? Both gritty and talented. And you can model what they do. So what world-class experts do is they do not just practice, but deliberate practice, which has certain features. When they are working on what they do, it's with a really specific and intentional goal in mind. Not like, yeah, I'm here to do a better job today, but you know, I'm working on the angle of my elbow as it, you know, reaches into that kind of thing. So really specific. They work on weaknesses, not strengths, right? So they're comfortable being uncomfortable. They're falling down a lot. They're playing things that are too hard. They're attempting challenges that are too high. They're getting feedback. And you know, Shaun White was actually in the New York Times Magazine a few weeks before the Olympics. And I know he didn't medal, but he's still really good at what he does.
Yeah, he's pretty impressive.
And so he was being interviewed. He was watching videotape of himself after he'd come down from a run, which is what all experts do, you know, seek feedback as immediately as possible. I think what he said is actually also indicative of the attitude of sort of experts that one could just, you know, role model or emulate to kind of get a little grittier. So the interviewer asked him, so it wasn't not a particularly good run, and apparently he's trying to do a kind of, you know, snowboarding or whatever that's new for him. And the interviewer said, why don't you just go back and do, you know, something else that's, you know, a little more familiar. And he said, I don't want to be the kind of person who, you know, doesn't finish what they began. So the other thing I think about, you know, gritty people, as they sort of do deliberate practice and try to get better and get feedback and work on specifics and work on their weaknesses, et cetera, is that I think they actually conceive of themselves as the sort of person who is, you know, loyal to their interests and steadfast about their goals and, you know, a harder worker. If you ever listen to Will Smith, you know, he says, nobody will outwork me. If you and I get on a treadmill together, two things. Either you're getting off first or I'm going to die.
Wow.
It's really that simple.
Man, the great philosopher, Will Smith.
I love Will Smith.
He's
so much
cool.
More fun to listen to than reading philosophy, too. So I think in terms of building grit, you know, you can look at gritty people and say, you know, how do they think? How do they approach their lives and what do they do? And then I know that a lot of people in the audience, you know, you run organizations, and I think there's a really important role. If you want to shape human behavior, organizations, culture, you know, values, norms, like that's the way to do it. So I think there probably are companies that embody and promote grit more than others. I think there are countries, like in Finland, they have this word called sisu, which roughly translates to grit. And in Finland, people talk about, you know, building their sisu. Young children in Finland talk about when you do a hard thing, you need to use sisu. And if I do a really hard thing, you know, my sisu will get stronger. And I think actually there are companies who kind of have this very self-aware, you know, identity as, you know, at the corporate level, right, at the organizational level, pursuing things with focus, you know, not getting too hung up on any given obstacle, being flexible, in fact, about the sort of, you know, well, if I can't get there this way, I'll try that way. But the vision, you know, the mission that organizes that company is stable and true. And then, of course, the people in the company work really hard.
Let me ask you a last question about that. Most of the people who are in this field face failure. We face failure often, right? All you need to do is open up a New York Times, you see seven stories on cybersecurity, and it's a very interesting discipline in that you face failure, but then you have to come back and you know you're gonna face it again. And we're almost in this period where we're starting to accept failure more as a piece of what we do. Any advice to folks who every day that's part of their makeup, that's part of, do we embrace it?
Yeah, I mean, you know, obviously failure isn't so great that we should actively seek it out, right? I mean, you're trying not to fail, right? But failure actually carries a huge amount of information, right? So in particular, you know, embrace it in the sense that it's just a necessary part of the process, which is why when I said that experts are working in their discomfort zone, right, it's, you know, they're working where they're failing more than they're succeeding and thereby growing and learning. The thing to embrace is probably the information that's carried in failure. Not like, I failed, I'm gonna get up, and I'm just gonna be resilient, but why did I fail, and how do I adjust so that the probability of failure is lower, you know, in the next round when, in fact, I am gonna get up again and do it. So it's not just, I think, the security industry. I mean, if you look at world-class athletes, world-class chess players, world-class violinists, world-class mathematicians, and they're all faced with the same, you know, difficult psychologically challenge, but really, I think it's a universal for learning.
Angela, thank you so much for being
thank
here.
You.
Really, really
it
appreciate it.
Thank you.
Take care. I'm so thrilled to have our next guest. He is personally one of my favorites in the security space. Completely brilliant guy. I'm sure many of you are familiar with him. What you may not know is that Dan Geer has his PhD in biostats, but he's been working in the security field forever. And in my personal opinion, conversations with Dan, I think he's one of the smartest that we've got. So I'd like to welcome up Dan Geer. For coming. We built an exercise program into the session this year. They said it was for me, but everybody else has got to do it too.
No, the bananas are for you.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Would you care for one?
No,
I don't mean to be rude.
It's okay.
All right. And thanks for coming.
My pleasure.
So let me ask, you've been doing a lot of work and thinking over the years around metrics and metrics in security. Sure. And you heard Angela's discussion, some of the things that she's done around measuring human potential. Where do you think we are today around predictive analytics, specifically thinking about the data that we have online and how that data can be used to predict a person, to predict something that's going to happen in a company?
We're very close, and by that I mean very close in the sense of being able to predict better than you would have thought. That's a little vague, but this is a little bit of a vague business, the business of prediction. I'm trained as a statistician. I'm trained as a public health statistician, so that brings with it a certain bias, which is the bias of thinking like disease models. But at the same time, the kind of data that we can now collect has, if anything, caught up with and surpassed our ability to look at it. That will not last long. Given the position that I occupy elsewhere, I can tell you that there are lots of startups now looking at exactly this, and I think it's fair to say that nearly every leading-edge security product has a behavioral component, where behavioral may mean something as simple as, we do a good enough job at knowing what is normal that we can detect what is abnormal or what's an anomaly sufficiently well that you can act on it. But there's more to it than that, and yes, as I think he knows, I'm married to a behavioral psychologist, so of course I'm an experimental subject. And
is she worried?
No. No, she's not worried. But the our ability to judge behavior and modify behavior has been understood well for some time, at least in the theoretic base, going all the way back to Skinner. You may not be a Skinnerian, but you know what I'm talking about. We are very close to where we could probably do a considerable amount of tailored reinforcement. And I would say that most days, as a security person, keeping honest people honest is a high goal. Keeping dishonest people honest is a harder goal, and by and large, I might not put all my eggs in that basket. But what I might do is say, I'd like to keep honest people honest. For that, we are very close to having the kinds of tools where you can, frankly, make book on it, that is to say, sell insurance on it. I'm not so sure about making dishonest people honest, but again, every high-end security tool I'm aware of is now talking about having a behavioral component.
Let me ask you a question, kind of based on something that Angela said. You think about data that at one point was not important and then suddenly becomes important. Social security numbers, I think, are a great example, right? When I went to college, my social security number was on everything. Like, you submitted a test, social security number's on it. You want to sign up for varsity ping pong? Social security's on it. It was on everything. It was a student number. And now, any one of those things would be considered a breach if you lost that piece of data. And the other thing that's more interesting even than that is if you took, say, the name of someone's pet that you'd happily discuss in any kind of casual conversation, that could unlock the keys to your digital identity with password reset questions. I bring those two examples up because when you think about the world that Angela is describing, if I knew that people were going to run this grit algorithm on me, I would be very careful never to mention that I dropped out of the chess club after 2 months, or that, you know, I really like stamp collecting, but I never progressed in my ability to collect stamps better. You know, there's a set of things that I would be careful. So I'm curious, when data that wasn't important suddenly becomes important, how do we create an infrastructure for something like that when we don't even know what it is?
You don't. You don't in the sense that repurposing data is not something that you can protect against. The thing that's going on now, and the reason that all this, I think you'll agree with me, matters, is that the so-called big data approach says that we can, in fact, do data fusion on multiple sources. We can take a lot of sources and correlate them. LaTanya Sweeney, who was at Harvard until she got appointed to the Federal Communications Commission, or was it the Trade Commission? I'm sorry, I forget which it was, about a month ago. Her academic specialty is re-identification. I am convinced that there is nearly no kind of de-identification process that cannot be reversed if you have enough data. I'm convinced of that. And even if I am wrong, the conservative assumption of someone who cares about that should probably be that de-identified data doesn't exist. If you are the Census Bureau, for example, what do you do when people ask you questions which, by their very nature, would tend to say that there's only one guy on the planet that has these characteristics? What they do is they send you manufactured data that has the same statistical characteristics but is completely manufactured. That is not de-identified, that's fabricated. Maybe that's as close as we're going to get. But the ability to do data fusion on disparate sources and not to be drowned by the volume, but rather just to be challenged by the algorithms, that's what's different now. And I don't see that going away. In fact, I see it far from going away.
It sounds like there would be equivalence classes then of data, right? So maybe I don't know that you're undergoing treatment for cancer, and that's a protected fact. But the fact that these other three pieces of data about you
sure.
would indicate that you are, but these are not legally protected, so it's not covered under PR.
Everybody's seen that, for example, Google is faster at finding flu epidemics than the CDC is. The Target was faster at finding whether a woman was pregnant or not than her family was. You know, the press is full of these because they all have a wow kind of quality. I suggest that you stop having the wow reaction.
Well, but be not surprised. But it,
no, I don't mean that in a, I'm sorry, I don't mean that in an evil sense. What I mean is that knowledge is power.
Yeah.
Knowledge is power. And we are collecting, well, I'm not sure you want to call it knowledge, because there is, after all, a sharp distinction between information and knowledge. Nevertheless, let me skip that for a second and say that if knowledge is power, and collecting information yields knowledge, I don't care what by what lossy function it yields it, then in turn we are creating a lot of power. And where does it go? Where does it go?
Yeah.
Does it go up? Does it go sideways? Is it peer-to-peer? Is it something else? We are still at the point where we can design that, but if we don't, it will evolve. It will evolve. I'm not sure what selection will produce, but it will evolve.
And it seems like it's cheaper today to collect a bunch of information. Forget about it. It's cheaper to collect and store it than even to think about if you should delete
Absolutely.
It or not.
Absolutely. I've not to sound like what this may sound like, I've written about this for some time, that I would think it was between 5 and 10 years ago, and probably closer to 10, we passed the point at which it was certainly far cheaper to keep something forever than to do selective deletion. Now, in the private sector, continuing to collect data is what one does until such time as one no longer has any idea about how to monetize it, so long as, of course, you're not under a compliance regime that says you must keep it. On the other hand, in other words, that the private sector will collect data, will continue to acquire data until such time as it cannot figure out how to monetize it. No offense to government, but government will collect data until such time as it cannot figure out how to store it. And that is a different stopping algorithm. Now, at the same time, if, as in the United States, 90% of the critical infrastructure, which of course where a lot of this instrumentation is going at present, if 90% of the critical infrastructure or 95 or whatever is in the private sector, what does that mean? The answer is they'll just get deputized. In the last 3 years have been an argument about that deputization. Data doesn't go away when it's collected anymore. Perhaps sometime it used to. Didn't the patent office burn down and destroy all the records in the middle, like 1830 or something like that? We don't have those anymore. We're not going to have a burn down event.
Yeah.
You know, maybe we should, but beside
maybe
that.
We should. Not incite violence. I promised them I wouldn't do that this year.
All right. Well, for those of you from Europe, in a sense, that is what the right to be forgotten argument is all about.
Will that ever be achievable?
No, absolutely not.
Wow, and
I'm not
very uplifting.
I'm not making fun of that because I can fabricate situations where it's long been thought that if you write the FBI and you say, I'd like to see the contents of my file, if you didn't have a file, they open a file and put your letter in it, right?
Is that the algorithm? This is previously unpublished. That's amazing.
Okay. But what I'm suggesting is that if I write in and say, I'd like you to forget something, is that itself something that should be stored? Why don't we have a record? Well, because we have his letter that he said he didn't want one. Let me do something that's closer to the RSA figures. If you've got a certificate revocation list,
Yep. It
is only useful if it's signed. What happens if the key in which CRLs are signed is itself compromised? Do you revoke the signatures on the CRLs? If you revoke the signatures on the CRLs, you are in effect reinstituting all the keys that had been on the CRL And what do you do about that? And besides, it doesn't actually matter whether the CRL is signed or not. What matters is whether you can prove to somebody after the fact that you bothered to check. That's what actually matters. And I'm just saying, I can fabricate situations like this where you say, like playing checkers. Well, that's a draw. We can fabricate. So the point is, no, it's not going to go away because a lot of these problems are undecidable. They're simply undecidable. Undecidable in the formal computing science sense. HTML5 is Turing complete. Hence, there will never be a way to decide whether a given HTML5 stream is secure, because to decide if it's secure, it's to solve the halting problem. HTML4 was not Turing complete. Tell me that's progress. No offense.
Well, I've never heard it quite put that way, but yeah, now that you say that. Let me ask, if you went forward 5 years from now, the progress that we're making in this type of data-infused analytics, where we're taking things from disparate sources, bringing it in. If you went forward 5 years, what do you think the key, I'm almost wondering things like laws, regulations, the types of data that will now be protected, classes of data. It was okay when it was social security numbers, because we could write GRAP, right, to figure out if there's a nine-digit number in a stream. But what happens in a world where we have to adhere to a set of almost non-combinatoric rules around data? How do you prepare for something like that?
I think he said it first, but everybody knows Bruce Schneier's term security theater. I think you're inviting theater. Now, I say that not because that means that it is worthless, but because the assumption that it is airtight is itself misleading. You know, with terrorism, for example, let's just stick to terrorism for a second, which is not, I realize, what you're asking about, but perfect prevention of terrorism destroys liberty. In other words, it is safer to do a good job than it is to do a perfect job. I think the same will follow with this. It will be safer to do a good job than a perfect job, and there will always be edge conditions, and I suppose then the question is, well, who pays? This being the United States, everything has a tort wrapped around it, so you know, maybe that's the argument, that there'll be some defined mechanism by which if this bad thing happens, a certain amount of money changes hands. I mean, the data breach laws are like that. Yeah. California SB 1386, and last I knew, 45 other states, 46 altogether, have data breach laws, and what do they say? They don't say it is illegal to lose data. They say, and when you do, you will do this and this and this and this. Now, I think those have reasonable futures. But I don't think what has a reasonable future is you must not permit this to happen. Simply because we can't anticipate the mechanisms by which things happen. Isn't the fundamental theorem of artificial intelligence that the weaker methods produce the more durable results? Whether I got that right or not, the idea here is that if I say things will happen and in turn, what will I do? You know, I'll tell you, this is an odd place to work it in, but I'll tell you what my definition of security is, and everybody can have one. Mine is a state of security is the absence of unmitigatable surprise. The absence of unmitigatable surprise. That you've achieved a state of security where those surprises that do happen are ones that you have a mechanism to cope with.
That's interesting, because that's a very fluid, almost societal evolving definition, too.
Well, it can track. It can track. Whereas if I say security is you have 128-bit keys on every one of these, and you're US TLS level 4.2 or, you know, whatever, that doesn't track. That doesn't track. Wow. You know, Moore's Law will get you, something will get you.
Wow, that's amazing. Hey, this was one of the most informative but not uplifting and happy kind of shows that we've done. Right.
And I didn't know that was my job. I thought that was your job.
On that point, so we do not launch a denial of Colbert attack, which I heard was the most dangerous thing on a Friday. Dan, thank you so much for being here. Really appreciate it.
It's great.
Folks, we've reached the end of our segment. I just want to say thank you so much for a great week. It's been a terrific conference, record attendance for us.
But I also think that there's a spirit of innovation that's just been, I don't know, I've felt it more this year than I have in the last few years. And I wanted to leave you with a final point. You know, we run a program on Monday of RSA Conference called Innovation Sandbox. It's meant to be a celebration of innovation and security, where people come together, have ideas. We teach them how to create startups out of those ideas. And one of the most interesting things that I've seen over this past year is talking to folks that have terrific, transformative ideas in security, but are not doing anything with it. And so if I'd leave you with one charge for the next 12 months, is feel free to challenge precedent. I think that's one of the most dangerous things we have in security is precedent. We've decided on how you secure A, B, or C, or what an infrastructure should look like. The threat environment is changing so quickly that I don't think the precedents of 10 years ago really matter anymore. So I want to leave you with that. Thank you so much for a terrific week. I look forward to seeing you next year. And in just a few short minutes, Stephen Colbert. Take care.